William Morrow and Harper Audio present Assassin of Reality, a novel by Marina and Sergey Dyachenko, performed by Jessica Ball. To my husband, Sergey Dyachenko, and to our beloved daughter, Anastasia. Prologue. Someday, my dear, you will be approached by a stranger. This stranger will bear no ill will toward you. He will assign you a task, ridiculous and rather unpleasant, and you will complete this task every single day. You will do that with no exceptions or excuses, because if you miss even one day, something terrible will happen to your loved ones. Your advisor really does not wish you ill. He will bring you to the Institute of Special Technologies, a place where only the dead get expelled. And you will become a model student, one who does not miss classes, who studies as diligently as she can, and sometimes even more diligently than that. Eventually, the day of the final exam will arrive. You will enter a spacious hall to cease being human and become a word of the great speech. You will long for this. This is your destiny. You wanted desperately to become a word. You studied hard, the top of your class, and yet... Chapter 1. Alexandra woke up a split second after her dark blue Skoda crossed the centre line and drifted into the oncoming traffic. A local bus rushed straight at her, its lights blinding Alexandra. The bus howled, and the driver must have howled as well, but the mechanical roar drowned his stream of obscenities. Seeing nothing, obeying her instincts, Alexandra twisted the steering wheel to the right, then all the way to the left, its brakes screaming. The car slid to the curb, then rolled down to the river, stopping dead a couple of feet from the concrete bridge support. Alexandra somehow found the presence of mind to turn off the engine. She sat still for a while, listening to the creaks and groans of the car. All kinds of sirens yelled above in different voices. Never before had Alexandra Konyeva, ni Samokhina, fallen asleep at the wheel. She glanced at her watch. It was 5 in the morning. That meant she had been with her husband for almost 48 hours, and these 48 hours were not spent in the throes of passion. They began like two responsible adults, well aware of the value of a fair agreement. However, the longer they'd conversed, the quicker the diplomatic veneer had disappeared, melting like a layer of gold leaf, and fake gold leaf at that. First, they lost their poise, then their ostentatious benevolence. At some point, they went to different rooms to cool off and compose themselves. At the start of the second round, however, they almost immediately slipped back into a low-class, shrill, revolting squabble. Their marriage had been doomed for quite some time. Alexandra had hoped for a civilized divorce, but even that was no longer possible. She'd given 15 years of her life to a worthless, empty, vicious, and vindictive man, and now it was ending, abrupt and dirty. Not bothering to wait for sunrise, she'd started the car and drove toward the city. The road calmed her down, pacified her, and gave her a strange sense of hope. After all, she wasn't even 35 yet, and her life was far from over. Finally relaxed after the terrible couple of days, she'd fallen asleep instantly, gripping the steering wheel and staring at the road markings as if at a hypnotist's pendulum, until a local bus had rushed straight at her.
"Sasha, honey, what happened? Why did you come in a cab?"
Mum stood in the doorway, a robe over her nightgown, the habitual anxious expression on her face. She worried about every little thing, and so Alexandra never told her the truth.
"I stalled on the highway and had to call emergency services. They towed my car to the mechanic. Don't worry, it's some minor issue. Go back to bed."
"How's Ivan?" Mum asked, a bit calmer now.
"Ivan says hello, he's fine. He'll take care of the cottage's new boiler." Alexandra went into her room. By a previous agreement, her 13-year-old daughter, Anya, was sleeping over at a friend's house. Anya loved sleepovers. She felt cramped in their old two-room apartment under the watchful eye of her grumpy grandmother and permanently aloof mother. Alexandra didn't blame her. She sat down at her desk, hung her head, and tried to compose her thoughts. Death had flown by, granting her a short panic attack that meant she hadn't had to think about much of anything. Followed by 40 minutes of euphoria, and now a wave of depression. She glanced at the digital photo frame on her desk, the kind that was fashionable many years ago. The frame shuffled through a handful of sentimental old photos. A young Sasha with her mum at the seaside, Sasha's high school graduation, Sasha's first assembly at the university, Sasha's wedding to Ivan Konev, Sasha holding a swaddled newborn on the hospital steps, mum with baby Anya in her arms, and again, a young Sasha with her mum at the seaside. The slideshow stopped. The last photo froze in the frame. Sasha and her mum, tanned and joyful, posed at the edge of the surf. The sun lit up the sea, and the red metal buoy glowed in the distance, warning the swimmers not to go beyond it. Alexandra sensed someone's presence behind her back. She realised she couldn't move. "Mum, is that you?" There was no answer, but she knew it wasn't her mother. And it wasn't Anya. It certainly wasn't Ivan, changing his mind and coming back from the dacha. It was something different. Something simple and unimaginable. Like a bad dream that makes one want to hide under the blanket. "Who is it?" she asked. "It's me," a soft voice said behind her. Alexandra looked back. A few steps away, in the middle of her room, stood a girl of about 20, dressed in jeans and a light jacket, backpack straps on her shoulders. Her hair was pulled back in a ponytail, and her enormous eyes were full of terror, as if she were facing a serial killer armed with a circular saw. Alexandra jumped up. For a few long seconds, she couldn't figure out who the visitor reminded her of. And then she shuddered in comprehension of the voice's words and the uncanny valley effect of the intruder's face. The girl looked exactly like Alexandra Samokhina in her fourth year of college, and yet she didn't resemble her at all, and it was utterly incomprehensible. A sudden arrival of a young relative would be shocking and unexpected, but it wasn't insane. Such things did happen every now and then. One could certainly cope with something like that. A sudden arrival of a doppelganger from one's own past, however, especially a strange, distorted doppelganger, was a different matter. Some nightmares make do without monsters and wildfires. It is when they are at their most mundane that they drive humans mad. "Who are you?" Alexandra screamed. The girl blinked and took a step forward, her face growing paler by the second. Alexandra shrank away from her, bumping into the corner of her desk. The girl stretched her dry lips in an apologetic smile and touched Alexandra's shoulder. The world spun around. The girl's touch became a point of entrance into a different reality, like a breach in a spaceship that lets the cosmos in. As if two cans of fresh paint had been spilled, and one spot flowed into another, swallowing it whole. The girl stepped into Alexandra's consciousness, into her memory, into her existence. Protecting her mind, Alexandra shouted, "I want it to be a dream!" She woke up, a split second after her dark blue Skoda crossed the centre line and drifted into the oncoming traffic. A local bus rushed straight at her, its lights blinding Alexandra. Chapter 2. Traffic stopped on the suburban highway. Police lights flashed and sirens howled. The bus driver had suffered minor injuries, but the dark blue Skoda had been squashed into a pancake. "Looks like she fell asleep at the wheel," the EMT said distinctly. From a distance, Sasha was able to read his lips. Alexandra Samokhina, the woman who died on the highway today, never matriculated at the Institute of Special Technologies. She lived a life of her own, never having heard of the great speech, never recognizing herself as a verb in the imperative mood. Sasha stood by the side of the road, wondering if she should envy this woman or pity her. Yesterday, January the 13th, a student of the Institute of Special Technologies set off to take the most important exam of her life and pass it in order to become a word and finally reverberate. Instead of passing the exam, though, she now stood by the side of the road, shaking in the piercing wind, convinced for some reason that today was September the 1st, the official first day of school. But of which year? Catching a few suspicious glances directed at her, Sasha checked her reflection in a random car's side mirror. She looked perfectly ordinary. No scales or feathers, only a shocked expression on her face. But everyone at the scene looked shaken up. When accidents happen, like this one on the highway, it's hard not to consider one's own mortality. So, nothing to elicit stares or sideways glares. Still, she felt them. The ambulance carried the bus driver away. The body, covered by a piece of tarp, lay by the side of the road. Grim-looking cops stood nearby, smoking. A tow truck picked up the remains of Alexandra's car. Sasha wanted to get closer, but knew she could never do that. She was terrified of this woman, dead or alive. Or rather, not the woman herself, but the idea of her. The concept of that body, the same body she also seemed to own. Which one of them was the other's projection? Were they both projections of the same being? They weren't exact duplicates, that was for sure. The dead Alexandra had never met Farid Kozhenikov. Sasha looked around, studying the faces of strangers, searching for a man in opaque black glasses. Onlookers climbed out of the car stuck in the traffic jam. Someone was filming the scene with his phone. One of the bus passengers was wiping the blood off his scratched-up face. No one wore sunglasses on this cloudy early morning. Perhaps we are the same, she thought. Perhaps Farid Kozhenikov never existed in this world. Sasha recalled the raw terror on the face of Alexandra Samokhina when she saw her doppelganger. She felt a twinge of it herself, because what she had just thought was a fantasy, not the nightmare she was used to. No, Farid Kozhenikov could not be cancelled. He was in every shard of any text, in any draft, any sketch, any grammatical construction. It's impossible to live in the world where you exist, Sasha said to him once. It is impossible to live in a world where I do not exist, he replied. Although it's hard to resign oneself to my existence, I realize that. Back on January the 13th, something went wrong during the exam. That meant Sasha was being punished. And what had just happened to Alexandra Samokhina was a part of that punishment, and not even the most terrifying part. There would be something else, and that something else was getting closer by the second. In a minute or two, Sasha would wake up in front of her apartment entrance, in front of her childhood bedroom door, so familiar to the minute detail, and she'd know that something had, imperceptibly and irretrievably, but wholly tangibly, changed. She would walk into the room and see Alexandra, see herself, as she would be without the Institute. She'd claim this woman and see her entire life, and the other Alexandra would desperately wish to wake up, and she'd drive into the oncoming traffic, and the howling and the screeching would commence, and everything would repeat. Sasha pressed the tips of her fingers to her temples, trying to push the anxiety back in. Something slipped through the muddy stream of her panicky thoughts. A sound idea, perhaps even a solution, some help, an exit. At the Institute of Special Technologies, Sasha was an exemplary student. She knew not only how to claim people and objects, but also how to unlink time loops. She searched her mind and realized she hadn't forgotten that. which meant that all she had to do to break out of the nightmarish circle was to restructure the probabilities for Alexandra to survive. Piece of cake, she thought wryly. The instant rush of hope gave Sasha heart palpitations and moist palms. She walked away from the scene of the accident and placed her backpack on the wet grass, ignoring the inevitability of stains on her pants.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.